Good evening all, welcome to this new session. We will try to see some interesting MSK spotters which are useful in VIVA and also in short cases and your exams. So coming to the first case, the child presented with swelling in the right leg. You can see there is diffuse osteitis, periosteitis with chronic osteomyelitis in the tibia and fibula on the right leg. And also you can see there is a metaphyseal destruction on the medial aspect of the proximal tibia. So whenever you see this typical metaphyseal destruction on the medial aspect of proximal tibia along with chronic osteomyelitis, one of the differential you should be suspecting is congenital syphilis. If the patient is child and he has a long-standing history, definitely suspect congenital syphilis. So I have labeled this, you can see this is the metaphyseal destruction on the medial proximal tibia along with there is chronic osteomyelitis. So what are the other features of congenital syphilis? You can see these, they can be synovitis, osteitis, periosteitis, osteomyelitis and pathological fractures. So this metaphyseal destruction of the medial proximal tibia is called Wimberger corner sign or Wimberger sign. Don't confuse this with Wimberger ring sign which is seen in scurvy. Next we will try to see some different tibial lesions which are commonly encountered as spotters. So this is already seen, metaphyseal destruction of the medial proximal tibia in congenital syphilis. Here you can see. Next, this one is medial proximal tibial spiking. So medial proximal tibial beaking or spiking seen in case of Blount's disease. Next, here you can see this is linear transverse metaphyseal lines or bands seen in leukemia, lymphoma, infection or growth arrest lines. So this is that Lucent transverse metaphyseal lines or bands. Next, these are dense transverse metaphyseal bands which are commonly seen in heavy metal poisoning or lead poisoning, chronic anemia, chemotherapy, rickets, etc. Here you can clearly see this is that metaphyseal corner fracture. Here you can clearly see this is metaphyseal corner fracture along with if there are fractures of the posterior ends of the ribs and with suspicious history in a child, definitely suspect child abuse or battered baby syndrome. And this is a case of metaphyseal widening. Here you can see this is metaphyseal widening with growth arrest lines, classically seen in case of this is a classical case of osteopetrosis. So this is nothing but Erlenmeyer flask deformity, which can be also seen in osteopetrosis or Coats' disease. Next, this is the other child with, here you can see there are multiple lucent areas and markings which are seen on the inner surface of the skull, which is causing remodeling of the skull. So whenever you see this type of appearance, definitely suspect, definitely do a CT scan and along with 3D render volume renderings images. Here you can see these are the prominent convolutional markings on the inner surface of the skull due to chronic compression by the gyri on the inner surface of the skull, which leads to this complete impressions on the inner surface of the skull, which makes the copper beaten appearance, copper beaten pots. So this is nothing but called copper beaten skull or copper beaten silver beaten skull or beaten brass skull appearance, which is classically seen in case of raised intracranial pressure in children and which may be seen in conditions like craniosynostosis, obstructive hydrocephalus, intracranial masses. So always do 3D volume rendering to better demonstrate this copper beaten appearance skull. Next we'll try to see other types of skull so that we can complete the continuum. So these are multiple punched out lytic lesions in the skull seen in case of multiple myeloma. These are multiple sclerotic foci scattered in the skull with bony expansion and remodeling of the skull seen in Paget's disease. There is a single well-defined lytic lesion in the skull in a child, suspect Langerhans cell histiocytosis. And here you can see there are multiple thin lucencies typically noted in the calvarium. This is nothing but salt and pepper skull, which is due to resorption of the trabecular bone, classically seen in hyperparathyroidism. Next, here you can, this is a child, you can see there is a complete destruction of the vertebra and which is nothing but plate like. So this is a classical case of vertebra plana. So what are the other cases, common conditions where you can encounter vertebral plana is Langerhans cell histiocytosis, most common in children. Others may be leukemia, metastasis, myeloma, lymphoma, hemangioma, osteoporosis and trauma. So we'll try to complete the continuum of vertebra. Here this is a case of vertebra plana as we have already seen in case of Langerhans cell histiocytosis. And here you can see this is picture frame vertebra. There is sclerosis around the corners of the vertebra, classically seen in Paget's disease. Here you can see diffuse sclerosis of the one vertebra, which is described as ivory vertebra, seen in lymphoma, osteosarcoma, osteoblastoma, osteoblastic metastasis, Paget's chordoma. Here you can see there is indentation or step-in deformities or indentations over the superior vertebral end plate and inferior vertebral end plates of the vertebra, typically described as H-shaped vertebra or Lincoln log vertebra seen in sickle cell disease. Here you can see there is fusion of the vertebra with loss of IVD space, and this is block vertebra, and these are multiple osteoporotic vertebra typically mimicking codfish vertebra, which can be seen in osteoporosis, osteomalacia, renal osteodystrophy, homocystinuria or spherocytosis. So this one slide sums up all your vertebra. You can easily remember in one slide. Next, here this is a adult who has presented with swelling around the ankle. You can see there is increased density of the bones, there is destruction, even debris, even disorganisation, distension of the joint and dislocation of the joint, along with, you can see there are arterial calcifications. So this gives indirect clue that he may be a diabetic. So this was a case of a classical density change, destruction, debris, distension, disorganization and dislocation, the common 60s we encountered in Charcot joints. So other conditions, common conditions where we can expect Charcot joints are diabetes mellitus, syndrome-arthritis, neurosyphilis, traumatic spinal cord injury, poliomyelitis, leprosy, steroid use, etc. And we'll try to see some common calcaneal pathologies which we encounter. Here there is fragmentation and sclerosis of the apophysis of the calcaneum, which is calcaneal apophysitis or Sievers disease. Here this is calcaneal apophysitis or Sievers disease. So this is calcaneal apophysitis or Sievers disease. Here you can see there is a bony spur arising from the posterior superior aspect of the calcaneum with retrocalcaneal bursitis. So this is Haglund deformity with retrocalcaneal bursitis. Here you can see there is a lucent lesion, lytic lesion with sclerosis with small nidus inside it in the calcaneum, which is classically seen in intraosseous lipoma. This is cockade sign. And here you can see there is erosions and irregularities at the level of tendo-Achilles attachment at the level of calcaneum, which is nothing but enthesitis at Achilles tendon attachment site, along with triad of arthritis, urethritis and conjunctivitis in case of Reiter syndrome. So easily remember, can't climb, can't pee, can't see in Reiter syndrome. Next, this is patella. Which is very higher up, and also there is a bony lesion which is projected over the knee joint. In the lateral view, clearly you can see this is the patella, and there is a fragment which is also seen in the anterior to the anterior in the, at the level of infrapatellar Hoffa's fat pad. This is an old patellar fracture. So we will try to see other patellar cases which can be seen in exams. So this is patellar fracture along with lipohemarthrosis. You can see this fat fluid levels. And also this is patella alta, high riding patella. This is biparotid patella, where there is unfused portion of the patella, superior, mostly commonly seen in the superior pole of patella. Here this is patellar dislocation. So this is patellar fracture with lipohemarthrosis. This is patella alta, this is biparotid patella, this is patellar dislocation. Next, here also you can see there is a bony lesion with narrow zone of transition, which is typically causing scalloping of the cortex. And also you can see there are multiple fluid levels. So this was a case of aneurysmal bone cyst. And also similar lesion, you can see there is a large lesion with wide zone of transition in the cortical and juxtacortical aspect, causing cortical breach, even periosteal elevation and destruction. And also in the MRI, you can see there is significant soft tissue component which is extending into the soft tissues and even extending into the medullary cavity with marrow edema. And classically in the lesion, you can see multiple fluid levels. So this was a case of telangiectatic osteosarcoma. So common lesions where you can see fluid levels are benign tumors as chondroblastoma, osteoblastoma, fibrous dysplasia, hemangioma. Malignant tumors can be plasmacytoma, malignant fibrous histiocytoma. Tumor-like lesions are aneurysmal bone cyst, simple bone cyst, sometimes GCT, brown tumors and pseudo tumors of hemophilia. So these are multiple calcifications which are noted in the muscle planes, which are along the muscle fibers. So typically called as rice grain calcifications, rice body calcifications or rice grain calcifications in myocysticercosis. Here this is a filariasis which is detected in the soft tissues of metacarpus. Here this is multiple ovoid calcifications in the subcutaneous tissues. This is guinea worm calcifications. Thank you all.